already set up the environment already? Yeah, cool. So yeah, it's just, so typically with Clojure, you just need the JRE, so you don't even need the full Java SE, you just need the runtime environment, oops, you need to do that. And there's a build tool called Lightning, which is like AMP, Maven, Gradle. It's probably more like, it's like Maven, but without the XML. So it's actually quite nice to use. You're actually defining a project in Clojure rather than XML. And I think it's obviously, I try not to do anything without it at all. And it's a really nice, there's quite a range of editors there. I'm going to be using Spacemax, which is like an Emacs thing, but you don't have to use that. And I think that's about it. So we're going to use something called Figwheel, which is a lining up plugin. It's going to help us have this round trip experience as well. And that's going to help us create projects and also run them as well. So I do have a website which I'm developing that's supporting this workshop. And that is at practically.github.clojurescript. I'm going to make this bigger because it's the time. With an I, that's the only thing I could get, .github.io/clojurescript. So this has got a lot of stuff about CojureScript in general, so I'm not going to go through this because literally would be here all day. So I'm going to dive into the, there's a section on functional reactive programming. Yeah, you can fix my logo, which should look like this. And again, this is still a bit work in progress, but we're going to kind of cover some of this there as well. And there's a little presentation. So I'm just going to spend the first kind of 5-10 minutes just kind of giving you a bit of background, and then we'll kind of spend the rest of the time building stuff together. So in here, so this is just, I'm not going to go, it's 91 slides, so I'm not going to go through all of them, that would be crazy. So I'm just going to go through some of the things. So we all know kind of JavaScript, which is everywhere, so it makes a really good platform to deploy on, especially if you're doing web front-end stuff, and even command line stuff, people are using a lot of that there as well. It's really useful to kind of deploy things really easily through Node, so it makes it a really good platform, and it's really fast and responsive, but then the language is a bit quirky. Probably all we've seen like the good bits of JavaScript as well. And for me, I find JavaScript a bit of a complex language as well, which CojureScript for me is a bit more simple. So in JavaScript, you have like, actually the transition from JavaScript to CojureScript is fairly straightforward. So, and same thing with going from Java to Clojure. You basically take the function name, put it inside the brackets, instead of it being in front of the brackets, and you're not far off there. But so the syntax itself is really quite simple. It's the biggest challenge in learning Clojure or CojureScript is thinking in a functional way. With Scala, there's a lot of functional stuff you can add, and you can add little bits over time. With Clojure, you kind of are encouraged more you have to learn a little bit more functional stuff before you can really make use of it, before you can really excel with the language. So there's a bit more of an initial learning curve, but once you get over that first couple of weeks, then you can kind of learn everything, you just need to practice your art, I think. I took a little bit longer because I wasn't doing it permanently, but if you look at the, let's make this a bit bigger, if you look at the actual syntax, then we've got, we define a namespace. So it's like if you use Java or Scala, you're defining everything in a namespace. And then you're defining either functions or names for values. And a value could be something like one or Fred or fish, or it could be a collection. could be like a list or array or a set or a map that you give a name to, and then obviously rather than having to type in that list or collection everywhere, you can use the name that points to that collection. So with a function, you're defining a function, you give it a name, and we define a function with this function. So this is a function call, which is in a list. So the round brackets are a list. So everything in Clojure and ClojureScript is actually a data structure. And so we open up a list, we put our function call in there, which takes these things as arguments. And it defines a function with an argument list with some kind of behavior that we define, which is also in the list. And then we can call that function by putting it in the list, the first element in the list, with some arguments as well. And then to define a name for something, so we just basically do def name, and then the value, either a simple value or a collection type. We'll look at the collection types in a minute. And there's some other stuff, but we'll see that as we go through. And then there's one of the really important things about Clojure, one of the real benefits is this idea of built-in immutable data structures. So you've got a list, a vector, which is like an array. You've got a map, which is a hash map. And you've got a set. So these basically are, instead of doing any kind of type definition, you use these data structures to model the information that you're going to work with. And so you don't need to build like a type hierarchy. There are ways to kind of define things that are like types, but Clojure and ClojureScript is a dynamically typed language, so although there's lots of types underneath, especially with deploying it on Java, then there isn't the kind of class hierarchy you're defining. So in that sense, it's quite different to languages like Java and C#. And these are all immutable as well. So once you create them, it's like when you create a string in Java. Once you create it, you can't change it. You can apply something on that string and get a new string in return. And that's what we do with these immutable data structures. So if you have a vector of 1, 2, 3, 4, and you want to add the value 5 to that vector, to that collection, it doesn't change this one, it creates a new one. You get a new vector of 1, 2, 3, 4. And then there's lots of functions. That actually there's about 650 plus functions in the core of the Clojure itself. And most of them are about managing data, because the language is a data orientated language. So you've got things like mapping and reducing over things. It can iterate over things as well, filter out stuff. So there's a lot. Really useful things there for processing data, and that's what we kind of do a lot with most of the applications we do. We're taking some data in, we're doing something with it, and then we're returning a new value or a different value. So kind of once you kind of learn the immutable data structures and this kind of basic structure, that's kind of all there is to kind of learn. To the syntax and stuff, there's a few little bits and bobs, but it kind of does make it a lot easier. All of this, and one of the other things we try and do is try and have this idea of pure function, so a function without side effects. So we're creating a function called increment numbers. It's going to take an argument called number collection, and then we're going to use that number collection. We're going to take this increment function and map it over every single element that we find in this collection. And what increment does is just increment a value by one. So if we pass it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then we're going to get the answer of 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So what map does is basically pulls out an element from here, applies this function to it, and then keeps the answers internally, and then once it's got to the end of the collection, then it returns all the answers as well. So that's an example of functional composition, so using functions with other functions. So this is when your head starts to think, what's all this about? And that's if you want, when you understand that, then you've kind of got through that kind of first couple of weeks or a month or so of trying to understand how to do functional programming. Really, this is kind of like in getting on towards the kind of the Haskell realm of things, how Haskell does things. What we try and avoid is like impure functions, and this is a very simple example, contrived example. So define this value, this name, that points to this value, this collection. Still got the same, more or less the same function, but this time I'm passing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but I get 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. So what did I do wrong? I passed in numbers. Oh, I didn't actually use the argument I passed in. So the argument I passed in, I ignored, and I just used this value. So that's an example of pulling something in from somewhere else in the program. And if you start doing this throughout your entire program, then you can't really be deterministic about what your functions do. So we try and avoid this. Again, that takes practice. But this is kind of background stuff. I don't expect you to remember all of this, but just to kind of give you an idea about why we're doing some of these things. And then we get this idea of functional colonization together. I guess one example is the MapReduce sandwich. Has anybody seen this thing before? So we've got all our ingredients. We've got some bread, gherkins, cucumber, etc. We're going to map a function over all these elements. So we're going to map the function slice. So we're going to slice the bread and all the ingredients, chop the ingredients up. And then we're going to reduce that into one thing, which is a sandwich. So it's quite a neat example. And this is, this is how you do it in Clojure. So we've defined a function called slice. Here we're not using a function, but we're using a name that's going to basically resolve a function call to give us something. So we've got here all our ingredients, and we're going to map this slice function, which basically just puts this sliced string in front of everything. So it's going to take bread, it's going to add sliced to it. You're going to get sliced bread, sliced cucumber, etc., etc., etc. And to bring some of this all together, so we've got a make sandwich function, which is going to do the reduce, and it's going to take the sliced bread, sliced cucumber, etc. strings, it's going to put a comma in between them, in between these prepared ingredients. It's going to say, I need to put a comma in between prepared ingredients. I'll work out what prepared ingredients is. I'll say, I've got a map slice of all these things. What does slice do? It adds sliced to it. And then I can print it out and just do a make sandwich here, and make sandwich will be called, which will then trigger all the other ones. So that's basically, if you can do that, then I think you're kind of ready to just go off and do Clojure. But if you're not, we've got some practice to do anyway. So. And there's another way to do it. There's another form. You can use these little threading macros. If you don't like the kind of traditional Lisp style of doing stuff where you've got too many brackets, this basically takes the ingredients and passes it to the next function call as an argument, which goes in here. And like commas actually in Clojure and Clojurescript are just treated as white space, so they're completely ignored by the reader, by Clojure itself. So this is just to indicate where the argument would go from the previous function. So this line goes into there, then this line is evaluated and gives a result, puts in there, and then interpose and reduce. So you've got the map, interpose, reduce, and then you've got the output to the command line or the UI kind of thing. So it's just another way of writing it. Sometimes it's easier to understand the code when you do it that way. But if you don't understand that, then don't worry too much. And the whole point of doing this is so you can parallelize the whole thing, which on Java obviously makes an awful lot of sense. With JavaScript, I think you would do that. You just have multiple instances, multiple servers, multiple front ends, because if they're all dealing with immutable data, then that you can call whichever front end you want, whichever server or container that's running the front end, and not have to worry about managing state across everything, because if your program is immutable or dealing with immutable data, then you're not going to conflict. Because you don't have to lock things. You can have the database as kind of the central kind of repository. You can manage all that. Your application doesn't have to worry. There's a whole bunch of other stuff I'm not going to go through. And you can actually change state as well. If you want to change state, you would wrap something in what we call an atom. It's not very clear, unfortunately, basically. But so an atom is like a cardboard box that you put something like physical in. So if you put say you've got two children and you're only going to feed the children. Why this is a terrible analogy, but there we go. You put one child in the box and then you put the child in the box or the crib and then that child is tired, so you go and put that child away, and you can put another child in the box. So, but you're not changing the child themselves. You're actually swapping the contents of the box, but the actual things that are going in the box are unchanged, are immutable. And we'll see some of that when we're doing the actual examples. And so you're basically just wrapping an immutable data structure with something that you change, or something that gives the appearance of you changing it. And so an example is here, we joined in a game. This is a better example. Here's a better example. So we're using a ref, which is more or less the same as an atom, but you can kind of do multiple changes all at once and make them a transaction. So here we've got our players, which is a ref, which is this mutable box we've got, and we're just putting it back. So we can't have more than two players. We've got a game account, and we've got a starting account for Harriet, who's going to be a new joiner. Obviously, it's a bit hard-coded. There we go. And we're going to join the game safely. So we've got a name, the player's account, and the game account as arguments. And we're basically going to do all these three actions all in sync. So they're either all work, or they all get rolled back. And so we basically join the player to the game. We add 100 credits to their account just to give them something to start with, so get them hooked, so they'll buy some more credits, and we make lots of money and exploit them that way. And then we take off 100 credits from the game account, so we're not kind of spending more than we actually have. And then it all happens, so we just basically call that, join the game safely, and then we get the results of Harriet now has 100. Credits, our game account's gone down by 100 credits, and Harriet's then part of the game. So it just allows us to kind of manage these immutable structures, but in a way that we can actually still change things as well. And let's go for the functional web. So I'm just wrapping this up. So there's people build things with jQuery, which is the classic style. Millions of websites out there. But if you are building single page apps, that's where ClojureScript really fits in. So if you're just doing a little bit of kind of, you just need a little bit of JavaScript to make a little button do something on a page, then that's still jQuery. But if you're building these single page apps, that's where you would kind of delve into things like ClojureScript and obviously React as well. ClojureScript uses this Google Clojure stuff, so the actual code you generate. So it's basically taking Clojure and converting it into JavaScript, but minifying it and optimizing it and getting rid of all the code and all the functions that you don't actually call. All that gets stripped out, so you get a really small JavaScript deployment. So it's as efficient, if more efficient than a lot of the Java projects you see out there, because not all the Java people use Google Clojures as a library. So this is Clojures with an S, not a J, just to confuse people. But this is a really efficient library. It's what Google uses for Google Maps, etc. So it's really kind of a very effective kind of way to create JavaScript from another language, essentially. Yeah.
So we use this ClojureScript as well. Do we have the idea of like doing dev, don't run it because it's got
scale? Yeah, exactly. Yes. Okay. Yeah, so this that would be what you would run at production time.
Okay.
So there's an optimized flag basically in the setup. And you can see clojurescript in your browser as well, so when you're debugging, there's this idea of something called source map, so you can actually see the JavaScript as well. And you can pull in a lot of JavaScript libraries from this thing called CLJS.js. So one of the first examples I'll show is showing you React.js library but with inside clojurescript. And there's plenty of people using it outside there as well. And you're going to deploy this to the browser REPL. There is a REPL inside the JVM, and you can do it to Node.js as well. But typically I do stuff, if you do front end stuff, you're going to be doing it into the browser REPL. And we do that through lining. And we use the Chestnut template essentially to create a new project. So let's do that. Let's do some hands-on. So if you've got, hopefully everybody's got Java and Lightning installed. And let's see, where are my projects? Let's make a Devoxx UK directory, so I know what I'm doing, where I've got things, because I've got too many projects. And I'm going to create, this is actually in the, it's also in the, it's also in the function reactive thing, so if you, we're going to create an on project. Have we going to create an on project? Yes. So it's this on project clojurex, and we're going to do these few things here. So this is our feature list. And so to be able to do that, we're going to create this line new chestnut. So we're using line, and we're going to call new, create a new project, we're going to use the chestnut template, and we're going to give it a name. In this case, I'm using on clojurex. So if I use that name there. There we go. So that was quite good, because I didn't have to download any dependencies, but sometimes there are some dependencies you need to download, so it might take a few more seconds. So we've created a project, so if you go into on Closure, you can kind of see if you're used to like Java project, it's not 100 million miles different from that. You've got readmes, you've got a project CLJ file, which is your configuration for the project, how it builds it, how it deploys it, that sort of stuff. But it's a proc file if you wanted to deploy it on Heroku, there we go. It's nice. A readme, obviously you know what that's for. And then you've got resources, which is all the sort of web assets. HTML page, images, CSS, all goes there. And then we've got the source tree and a test tree. So like Java and Scala and C#, you've got, you create these namespaces and they're aligned with the packages. So here we're going to have a namespace called on clojurex. And inside that namespace there's a file called core. So we'll be able to, that'll be our namespace, and that namespace matches our path to our files. The only kind of difference is that I've got a closure namespace, I've got a closure script namespace, a closure script source path, a closure source path. And this is a closure common. So if it's CLJC, it means that it doesn't actually matter where you're actually deploying your closure to, it will just work. So you can deploy closure to Java, to JavaScript, you can also do it to .NET, you can even run it inside Excel spreadsheets if you really wanted to. There's a little project you can make it run instead of doing the VB scripting. And somebody's working on a closure to Go environment, so you can actually deploy it. And the nice thing about Go is you can make it really easy to deploy on lots of different platforms. Tooling in hyperconnection as well. So you just kind of separate them out into things. So obviously, the closure, that might have some Java interoperability code in there. It might not. The clojurescript might be calling some stuff in JavaScript, or it might not. But the closure comment shouldn't have any kind of calls to the underlying hosted environment. So it should be like common libraries you would use. And most of it, you can do an awful lot without having to do anything specific around that. As we'll see in some of the, as we'll see in the first example. So we've got a project. There's a lot of things in here. You don't have to worry about every kind of thing. It just kind of works as configuration. The interesting parts you would need to look at is the dependencies. So these are all the libraries we're using. So you've noticed we haven't actually installed Clojure anywhere. That's because we just put it as a dependency. It's just a jar file. It's only about 3.5 megabytes in size. The Clojure script one is only like a few. It's a few hundred K, it's like about 700K in size. So the Clojure script actually is the compiler into JavaScript, which is built on everything that's already in Clojure as well, so it's really lightweight. And this is creating a full stack application, because it's got front end and back end stuff, so things like Ring and Composure help you build like the back-end server, so the server-side web application. So if you want to do, if you want a server-side generating code, you want to do routing around there, you want to have a JSON REST service, that sort of stuff, you can use that with Ring. And then the only thing really we're kind of, apart from ClojureScript itself, the only thing we're adding that's specific to ClojureScript is this OM library. And OM is kind of the ClojureScript implementation of React.js, essentially. So we're going to still see a little bit of React.js underneath here. We're going to look at that. And actually, before I start, let's just have a quick look at React.js. Have I got that still? My bookmarks. So this is just an example of using it. We're not going to build this one, but we're actually it's an example of what we can do. I'm just going to start a repo because I want to show it off. But we'll go through this a little bit myself as well. So here we in this project, we're actually including React directly and React DOM. Library React is the kind of core libraries that model the React API. React DOM is the library that allows you to generate HTML tags and stuff, so you can make your content understandable to React. But pretty much everything else is the same. Model build stuff is the same. How we do things is, so we've included these React and React DOM as part of our namespace, so we can have access to the functions that are in those libraries. So it's just like an import in Java. And we've defined some state we're going to manage. We're using an atom for that. So our state is essentially just going to be a map with some a display. So this is going to be a calculator. So we're going to display a value on the calculator, and then as we press buttons, we're going to keep a history of all the buttons we press, and then we're going to run a calculator function over those histories and produce a result and update and display. that's our model. It's very simple, and we usually have a very simple kind of base model, and then just add things to that. And we take the model, and right down the bottom, we basically render that to the application, to our web page, essentially. So there's a div in our index.html file that's got this app ID, and that's going to be deployable on our JavaScript into that web page. And all we do is create a calculator component, and that's made up of other components, title, history, display, and so on. So we've got a master component, and lots of components underneath it. And then each of these components are defined in their own function, of their own dev in this case. And so we're doing it as dev because we've actually, to make it simple and take some of the JavaScript out of the whole application, we kind of try to keep these definitions very simple. So that's actually just pure closure. There's no JavaScript or React kind of things in that. But we basically pass this function into components, and it adds the kind of the JavaScript things, the conversion of JavaScript properties. So converting from maps, like we've got here, we've got a div that's got a class name. So we need to convert that from a clojurescript map into a JavaScript object. So some of this can be a bit, this is kind of tends to be the fiddliest bit of that, but we'll kind of have some experience of doing this. And we'll see a little bit more under the covers when we use Elm as well. And the same thing for Element as well. We're kind of basically generating elements, and we're kind of stripped out, instead of putting this little conversion function in to convert all our props, where we've got this function we can roll things through. So we're doing a bit of functional composition here. So this is an example. It's online. You can go and have a look at it later. But just to kind of show you something working. So this is still working. So I can go in and do 99 plus 1, and so the history is being put at the top there as well. I press equals, and that re-updates the display, and we've got a working application. It works. Oh, nice. That's always nice to see. So we're going to try and build something possibly a little bit simpler than this. We're going to build a schedule application, so it's just a conference schedule. So we're going to have a few components like we've got here. So we've got our components. We've got our history component, which just basically puts the history in a div and with any kind of properties of history. We've got a display, which just puts the div with the value of display. We've got a button which has this on-click handler, which is a little bit of JavaScript, and then we've just got this keypad, which is just building all the buttons essentially. So it's just creating an element. It's creating a button for each button. We put the buttons in the keypad, and then we put the keypad in the calculator along with the display of the history, and so it all kind of nicely joins up. And actually, I was quite surprised how clean you could actually keep this, because I've only got like three or four functions that have got anything to do with JavaScript in. All the other ones are purely CloudScript, so that's quite nice. So we created our own project. We've got dependencies, that's what we'll do. Kind of review them. So, yeah, the project thing gives us our libraries, and then inside we've got this source on clojurex. So this is the file we're going to have a look at now. So if you go into your project, into the source, it should be something called on clojurex, and then CLJS, and then source, CLJS, subs, just on, that's our application. It actually works. It's got a working app. It doesn't really do much. You might be able to guess what it does by looking at the app state, because it doesn't really do much more than what the app state makes you think it does. Any guesses what it does?
Prints a little JSON.
Yes, it does. Yes. Congratulations. You win a prize. You win a sticker. There we go. Okay, let's quit the other REPL I was running. So if we start up the REPL, we've got in here we've got a few things in the function. We've got enable console print, which is just going to help us print out things to the browser console window. So if we want to do any debugging, like the print line debugging, you can still do that in Clojure as well. We've got this state, which just basically wraps a map with key text and hello chestnut in there. We've got a root component, which is just our render function. And so it's just basically going to create a h1 tag in HTML, and the value that's going to be inside that tag is just going to be pulling the text, the value that the key text is pointing to inside that. It's going to pull that out and display it. So in our atom, we've got this map, and it's got one keyword called text, and that points to chestnut. And if you use this form, so we're actually using the keyword as actually a function call to say, well, give me the value that text points to from my collection. And my collection is called app. Well, actually, that should be called, yes. Because we, oh yeah. So we actually call this root component from this on root. So we're calling root components. We're going to pass it app state, which is our state here. So we're going to effectively pass it this atom. And then that atom is going to be given the local name app. And we're going to be able to just like extract from app the value that text is pointing to. So is this okay? Do people understand what we're doing here? It's like doing a get. We get the value that text points to from this collection. It's just it's a bit of a shortcut.
Where is it rendering to owner? Like is it passing in the div? But then I see it saying render, but I didn't. Is that that square brackets and underscore? Is that using owner or something? Or?
Oh, sorry, yes. So what this root component is doing is we've got this very strange type of function called readify. So it's just basically checking that that we're going to provide a function that satisfies this iRender interface.
Okay.
Or actually it's a protocol kind of thing in JavaScript, but for in terms of like Java kind of background, I've got this iRender interface. I'm going to check with readify that I'm actually satisfying that. So I'm actually going to, so I provide this render function, which is is in this iRender interface. So if I don't have a render function, or if I call this something else, the application will give me an error, essentially. So it's just checking that I'm honoring the interface. So this is a little bit more of a type approach. So you can have def records and def types to do that. So this is a bit more, if you like different types, you can probably gravitate to more of this kind of style. But yeah, it's essentially saying render. I'm going to render this. So when I can either put in this or the underscore, because it's this object that I'm working with, this component I'm going to render, and I'm creating a div. With here, I'm not going to give it any properties, and the div is going to contain a h1 without any kind of style, and that h1 is going to have the value that we pull out from the app state that's pointed by text. Am I leaving you behind?
That one makes sense. I just don't see how owner is used, how is it, so that render is run against owner.
Oh yeah, so yeah, so it's this on route that basically, so you've got this starting point that's going to assemble all your components. So under here, we're calling this root component, which is the function above, and it's passing that root component the app state, and the owner itself is implied that it's the owner is on route.
Yeah.
So it's the call, the thing that's called that essentially.
Okay.
It's a little bit convention rather than configuration. So it's just something to kind of get used to. And then this app is on your HTML page. You've got this div, which has got an ID of app. So that's where your JavaScript would be put into, and this is what is output when you do a deploy or when you're actually just running a REPL. It's creating this JavaScript script. So that's already built. So when I run the REPL, that's what it's going to build, and makes it a builder straight away. Ever lost people? And then we want to start a REPL because we want to be able to kind of build something as we're, we want to see what it's doing as we're building it. So there's a couple of ways. So you've got this, you can, if you're using, anybody using Spacemax or Emacs? No, it's me. If you're using IntelliJ cursive, you should be able to just start a REPL. If it doesn't start a clojurescript REPL, then you're essentially, start a REPL, and then you can do this on the command line. So if you're not sure about your editor, then inside there you can go in your tiny project, you just do line REPL, and it should give you a REPL prompt. And then once that's up, you would run, you just type in run in brackets, enter, and then you would kind of do some more stuff, and then you would type in, and that's when you should type in browser REPL. Then once you've got those two, once you've done the browser REPL, then you just need to open up your browser tab or a browser window at localhost 3419. Or you just use that link, should work. And then that allows your command line to connect, or the REPL to connect to the JavaScript engine inside your browser. And then you should have the hello chestnuts. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to do that in my editor because I've got used to doing that now. So it does take a few seconds. Because if it's the first time it's running, it might download some dependencies. It is also compiling for the first time if you've got a lot of, you've got CSS, if you've got like a CSS pipeline, you can feed that into that as well. And it's, at the moment, most of the tooling is still using the Java virtual machine to actually run all these tools. So even though we're creating JavaScript, we're still running JVM. So that's part of the reason why it's a little bit slower. It's only got a couple of JVM instances to build it. It's now set starting fig wheel, so I should go, be able to go to my refresh. Oh, just now, yay! Has everybody got this far? Yeah.
I have, but I have to do slightly different steps. So when I try to call REPL, I get me an error. but then it said you could start Figma with a Figma sidecar and then some.
Oh, right, okay, yes. Yeah.
So I run that, and then I could run Browser Wrapper, and now I can see it.
Excellent, yeah. There's, I'm not so familiar with cursive, but yeah, it's the same kind of thing you do with some experiments as well. You mean it's like a little setup kind of thing you do. Here I'm just telling you to use the Browser Wrapper by default, and I think that's what you were doing there with Sidecar. Sidecar's again a plugin that Figma uses to start up the REPL and connect to the browser. Cool, so if we've all got that connected, so we can now we can kind of interact with the project. So if you're that should be in MS. So you can go to the REPL window, so I'm going to open mine. So you probably have a REPL window or something like that with some kind of instructions about how to work with Figwheel. So it actually starts up. You actually started up two REPLs. So you started with the Clojure REPL, and then from the Clojure REPL, you then started the ClojureScript REPL, which connected to your browser. So you should, if you got the CLJS user, then you should be able to interact with it. But at the moment, it's in the user namespace and not in the on ClojureX.core namespace. So we couldn't actually call any of these functions yet, because it doesn't know where they are. So we have to change our REPL to be part of the right namespace. I want to go into another namespace. I want that to be on and then I could go and see what the things I can go see what the app state is. Which should be any clues? It's hello Chesters. There we go. So you can go in with a REPL, you can go in and go and find out what's actually going on in your program quite easily. You can go and test things out, try things out. You can actually build a lot of your application from the command line. From the REPL, sorry. And so here all I've done is just said, tell me what app state looks like at the moment. And because app state is an atom, then we've had to use this little at sign in front of it, which is like the equivalent of calling a deref function. I could have done deref. That's well, sorry. That gives me the same result. So the app sound is just a shortcut for the deref function. So if I actually define something else in here, if I just define the value of that. So if it's just a normal thing, so if it's just a string or a collection, then I can call it by its name. If I'm wrapping that name in an atom, then I have to deref that. Any questions so far? So what happens in the and so I can just add things as I want to. Here my editor is connected to my REPL, so I can evaluate things in here and it will all go into the same namespace. I'll try and do some other things in the REPL here. So we've got on core and on DOM. So these are core functions and the libraries generate the H1 tags, etc. I've got a root component that's going to create my single page app. into this div on my HTML page. So what my root component does, it takes the app state as the local name app. It's going to pull it out as text. And so if I actually, I could actually go in and do swap the app state. See the changes as I make the changes in the REPL, or if I actually make the changes when I save code, then I see that straight away in the web page I'm building. If I change this to dev, then I can save the file. So you can kind of instantly get that, you get that feedback, you can see exactly what it's doing on the web page as soon as you change that as well. The reason this was def once is because we don't, every time we save the file, we don't want it to have to, we don't want to update the state from this kind of default position. We don't want to reset the state every time we save it. If we actually refresh the browser, it would do that. If we manually refresh the browser, it changes the state. But we want to kind of have a starting point and then let our program change the states, or let us change the state during the REPL and see how things go there as well. So I'm going to put it back to defaults. And I'm going to move these things around so they don't run too much. So we've made some changes in the REPL, so I can, we've done this. So basically, we have to, because our app state is, again, wrapped in an atom, we have to use this swap function. And there's a convention that if you're going to change something, you put a little, like an exclamation mark. So this is a function that mutates the state, essentially. We're going to work on the app state. And we're going to change that app state by associating some value where the key is, and the value is this string. So we're going to basically replace this text, the value that this key is pointing to, so null and hello, world effort, the value of all that kind of thing. Does that make sense? Oh dear.
Unable to resolve
simple
context.
Are you in the right now space? If I'm going too slow, feel free to kind of power on through this. So, yeah, we've made some change in the REPL. We've got, so we're going to create rather just have the text, we want to change the model we've got. We want to have a name, something in our state that holds the name of our conference. So actually, we can kind of change this. You want to see the answer, you just press this little button and it shows you the answer. Or you can work it out. It's once you're familiar with closure, this is quite easy, but the first time you do it might be a bit weird. So we're asking you to create a key called conference and then give it a value of the conference, so Devoxx UK. So we've got Devoxx UK there as a string. And rather than text, I can have the conference. So I can change my app model. Obviously, this is going to break. So if we save this and go back to our UI files, it's broken. Well, it's not broken, it's just not showing anything because obviously in my render function here, I'm asking it to render text, which no longer exists, so I have to change that to conference. Save that. Hey, it works again. You might notice a little green circle in there, it's just showing you on the page that it's done an update. So it's a nice visual feedback. If I do something like that, then that would work. I'm trying to break it, and I always have problems breaking things. Let's see, that should work. Yeah, there we go. So if you do kind of get errors, it brings this nice compiler warning stuff up there as well, and it shows you, look, it's showing me that I'm trying to call fish and I haven't defined it. So get some nice feedback in there. So all I did was just type this fish, call to fish function, which I don't actually have defined. And it should even show me kind of like the line 7. And it's not showing me the error in the generated JavaScript, it's showing me the error in the clojurescript that's generating the JavaScript, which is generating the error. And the same in the browser as well. It'll show you, if you're debugging, it'll show you the errors in the clojurescript, not the JavaScript, because the JavaScript is a different language. So we get the fish. We have time for an hour there too already. Let's see, so we've got Devoxx. Let's just there's a pin. Pin. Do that together. What did I do for my answer? So we want to create an app state for these kind of things. So these kind of information, we want to capture this in a session. So how do we do that?
Another element?
Yeah, so I can create another element under here and call it session. And then there's lots of information under here. I could just do a bunch of strings in here, like just for the kind of information. But it's the problem with this is that I don't really know. I look at this model, I don't really know what any of these kind of values relate to. I could like guesstimate. So rather than using a vector and just putting the values in there, I can have another map. So you can have maps within maps, and you can have vectors within maps, and maps within vectors, and all sorts of stuff. So you can have a quite nested collection for your model. So with session, I would have something like title, so Any questions so far? So rather than just do one, because it was a very boring conference if it was only one talk. So we're going to do multiple sessions. So we're going to have kind of a model like this, like sessions.